He's a man of mystery, an interpreter of dreams. He was thrown in the lion's den.
Call upon your name, O one.
The three Hebrew boys.
God, save me!
Why do they not burn?
The finger writing on the wall. A book written between the 6th and the 7th century BC. It's the apocalyptic book of the Old Testament. Join the Reverend Dr. Dylan Toussaint Wednesday nights at 7:30 for The Daniel Story. A book written by Daniel himself. The Daniel Story, Wednesday nights at 7:30.
Welcome, one and all, to the online Bible study series of the Edgewater-Waterford Circuit of Baptist Churches. A special welcome to those overseas. Please be reminded that God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in troubled times. And may our time around God's Word be enlightening and enriching. But before we go any further into our study, let us pray. Almighty God, we pray now for your insight and inspiration as we again study your word. Make us therefore receptive and responsive to your still small voice. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, last week, we focused on Daniel chapter 3, verse 1 to 7, under the sub-theme, the golden image. In so doing, we highlighted four main things about the golden image. One, we highlighted its description. We said last week that this image was 60 cubits high and 6 cubits wide. That is, if you remember, approximately 90 feet by 8.6 feet. Secondly, last week, we noted its location. And in terms of its location, the plain of Dura is where the passage states that this image was. It was perhaps chosen for its vastness and its easy access. Thirdly, last week we looked on its dedication. And in so doing, we noted that this was both a spiritual and an official event when this image, this golden image, was dedicated. And then finally, last week, we looked on its veneration. And this was enhanced by the playing of music, if you remember, and it was enforced by the threat of death. So those were the four main points from our study last week on chapter 3 of Daniel, verse 1 through to verse 7, entitled The Golden Image. Tonight we are going to be looking at Daniel chapter 3, verse 8 through to verse 18. And again, I'll be reading from the King James Version. Wherefore, at that time certain Chaldeans came near and accused the Jews. They spake and said to the king Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. Thou, O king, hast made a decree that every man that shall hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, shall fall down and worship the golden image. And whosoever falleth not down and worships, that he should be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. Now, there are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not regarded thee. They serve not thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage and fury, commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Then they brought these men before the king. Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, "Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Do not ye serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up? Now, if you be ready, that at what time you hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, you fall down and worship the image which I have made, well. But if ye worship not, you shall be cast the same hour into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands?" Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we're not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Tonight, we are entitling our series, "We Will Not Bow." We will not bow. I say it again for emphasis. We will not bow. And I'd like to begin by stating that this text is, of course, set within the context of Daniel's three Hebrew friends refusing to bow to the image as Nebuchadnezzar had decreed. That same image that we focused on last week, this golden image that many commentators and Bible scholars believe was essentially an image, a replica of Nebuchadnezzar himself. I'd like to suggest this evening that this was an act of defiance on their part, which would have been quite noticeable and punishable. Everybody would have noticed this, and it was deserving of punishment based on a decree that Nebuchadnezzar had made. Again, it is said that a picture is worth a thousand words. I'd like for you to look at this picture, this drawing, so an artist's depiction of the situation. You'll notice, of course, that image in the center there, the golden image. You'll notice, of course, that people are bowing, prostrate on the ground before this image. You'll notice that in the left corner, somewhere in the left side there of your picture frame, you will see what perhaps was where the king would sit and observe what is going on. And you can't miss it, that when everybody around is bowing, prostrate to this golden image, there are three persons there standing. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, their Babylonian names. They are standing when everybody else is bowing. It was quite noticeable, and it would be punishable. They were like a sore thumb sticking out in this picture frame, standing when everybody else is bowing. Now, it is quite likely that while they were standing, while they remained standing, instead of bowing to the image, they were completely, first of all, outnumbered. And when you look on the picture, it is clear. Of course, the story itself lends itself to that type of a reality, that they were completely outnumbered. Three of them, and everybody else is bowing, and only three of them are standing. Sometimes, beloved, in our Christian commitment, we'll be outnumbered. That if we always want to follow the crowd, if we want to follow what is popular, if we always want to follow the majority, we may end up on the wrong side of God's will. Following God means that sometimes, many times I should say, we may be in the minority and we are outnumbered. So this is not a popularity contest. This Christian life. This is not about following the crowd and bowing to peer pressure. Sometimes we'll be outnumbered. Many times, oftentimes, we'll be outnumbered in terms of our commitment to the Lord. And that is par for the course. But also, I'd like to suggest that they would have been considered odd. Odd. Not only outnumbered completely, but also odd, strange. Everybody else is bowing. What about you guys? Why are you so different from everybody else? What's up with this? And sometimes people will see you as odd, as strange, as even weird, queer, unique, because of the commitment to the Lord that you have. Completely outnumbered they were. And considered odd. There are three main points, however, I'd like to highlight in our study tonight. And the first point is the report of the Chaldeans. The report of the Chaldeans found in verse 8 and 9 and then verse 12. Let me read it for you again. Wherefore at that time certain Chaldeans came near and accused the Jews. They spake and said to the king Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. There are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not regarded thee. They serve not thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Now, please understand, beloved, that these certain Chaldeans would have been colleagues, yes, colleagues of Daniel's three Hebrew friends. They would have been associates, co-workers, colleagues, persons who would rub shoulder even with these three Hebrew boys or men at this point in time. And these same colleagues were the ones who were bringing their names to Nebuchadnezzar to accuse them. Perhaps these Chaldeans went out of their way to accuse Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, their Babylonian names, because of covetousness. Covetousness. That maybe they coveted, they wanted the positions that these three Hebrews held. And so they did everything humanly possible, including this, to undermine them and to get them out of the way. Covetousness. Covetousness is not only about things, as you know. You can covet in terms of people. And the Bible states that clearly in Exodus chapter 20, that covetousness is not just about things, it's about also people. It's about coveting a position that somebody holds that you desire dearly. And maybe because of this, quite likely actually, they brought them before Nebuchadnezzar. But even even more, even worse. That maybe they accuse them because of maliciousness. Maliciousness, yes. That there was malice in their hearts toward these three Hebrew boys. Please remember that before these three Hebrews were elevated and promoted to these esteemed positions, they were below the level of the Chaldeans. In fact, the same Chaldeans were perhaps among the persons who had taught them in chapter 1 and groomed them in regards to the Babylonian culture, if you remember when we started and looked at chapter 1. Now, these same Hebrews were their bosses, were in a superior role. These same Hebrews were in better positions than they were. And maybe from way back there was this malicious intent, this anger, this bitterness toward them. And now they took the opportunity to undermine them and to bring their names before the king. Interestingly, the Revised Standard Version actually states that they maliciously accused the Jews. And when you look on the accusation, beloved, the accusation that was leveled against these three Hebrews, it amounts to two things. First of all, they were accusing them of disregard for the king. Oh, king, they don't regard you. They are dissing you. They don't respect you, O king. They are disregarding you as a person by not bowing to this golden image. When you look at the accusation, it was an accusation of disloyalty to the king. That king, they're not loyal and they are not obedient to your commands, your dictates, your decree. And by doing this, it's a sign of disrespect, disregard, and absolute disloyalty to you as their king. That, in a nutshell, was the accusation that was brought to the king because they wanted to bring down these three Hebrews. I wonder if anybody here has ever encountered anything even remotely close to this. I wonder if there's anybody who's ever endured this type of a pressure, this type of a persecution, this type of an accusation. False, wrongly intended, badly motivated, and maliciously created. That was what these three Hebrews were facing. So that's the first observation I want to make. The report of the Chaldeans. But next, let us look tonight at the response of King Nebuchadnezzar. The response of King Nebuchadnezzar, found in verse 13 to verse 15. Let me quickly read it for you again. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage and fury, commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Then they brought these men before the king. Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Do not ye serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up? Now if you be ready, that what time you hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, you fall down and worship the image which I have made. Well, but if ye worship not, ye shall be cast the same hour into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And note this rhetorical question. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? May I suggest tonight that the response of King Nebuchadnezzar amounted to two main things. First of all, there's rage and there is fury. Rage and fury. according to verse 13. Put bluntly, he was angry. He was raging mad. He was really upset. He was irate. He was livid. He was very angry. The Bible tells us and warns us, doesn't it? In Ephesians 4, verse 26. Be angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath. Next, what we see in terms of the response of the king is ridicule and contempt. In verse 15. In verse 15, he's asking the question, if you remember, and who is this God? Who is that God that shall now deliver you out of my hands? What ridicule, what contempt for the God of these three Hebrews. Ironically though, if you remember from chapter 2, verse 47, this same Nebuchadnezzar had said to Daniel, your God is a God of gods and a Lord of lords or Lord of kings. That is what Nebuchadnezzar had said in chapter 2. And now he's asking rhetorically, as a form of ridicule and contempt, who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? It's interesting, isn't it? That on one hand, the people can talk a certain way, sound a certain way, speak a certain way. But when they have become overwhelmed with power, because at that time in chapter 2, this golden image was not yet created. But now that it is erected, he comes with a sense of pride and haughtiness. And he's saying, who is that God? Sounds familiar. Let me move on to the third and final observation from our text tonight. That along with the report of the Chaldeans and along with the response of King Nebuchadnezzar, I suggest that we also see the reply of Daniel's friends. Found in verses 16 to 18, the reply of Daniel's friends. Now, look at this again. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. Put another way, they are saying, we don't have any difficulty in giving you an answer to this matter. We don't have to be guessing and spelling. We are quite clear and resolute in our commitment. Hear them now in verse 17. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace. And he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. Verse 18 is interesting. But if not be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Their reply, beloved, indicated two things. And then I close. Their reply indicated, one, how confident they were in their God. Remember now what they said? Our God, King, we want you to know the God we serve, the true, one, and living God, is able to deliver us out of this burning, fiery furnace. He is able, and we believe he will. That's confidence. That God is able. And as we go through the crises of today, as we face the challenges of today, may we always remain confident, beloved, that our God is able. He is still able even when the going gets tough, even when it looks hopeless and helpless, our God is still able. He's still able. And that is the confidence that we need, especially in times like these. When your back is against the wall, when you feel frustrated, when you feel like giving up, when you feel as if you have reached the end of your rope, please remember, our God is still able. The God of Daniel and those three Hebrews, still able to deliver you. But even more, note how committed they were to their God. Along with the confidence in their God comes the commitment in verse 18. And it starts with the word but. Even if he does not deliver us, we won't bow. We will not bow. We are that committed to the very end that we will not bow. No matter what, no matter when, no matter how, no matter where, we will not bow. That now is commitment along with confidence. Put another way, it is faith moved into faithfulness. And this is where the rubber meets the road. This is where it becomes very dicey and difficult for many people. It's easy for persons to spout their confidence. Our God is able. But what if he does not answer our prayers the way we would have hoped? What if he doesn't respond immediately when we would have hoped? What if he says no? What if he does nothing? What if he does not come through for us the way we had anticipated and expected? Do we throw in the towel and give up? Do we turn to other gods? Do we renounce our faith? They were confident in their God. But even more, they were committed to their God, even if it meant death. And that is the core and the heart of a Christian commitment. Confidence in God's ability, but committed to God no matter what happens. As usual, I'd like to close with what I call questions to consider. And as usual, I have three questions. And I'm just going to run through them quickly and then I pray with us tonight. Question number one. Have I ever falsely accused anyone? And how should I handle instances when I am falsely accused? Number two. How do I ensure that I do not sin, especially when I am angry? Number three, if my life were under threat for doing so, would I announce or denounce my faith in God? Would I announce my faith? Or would I denounce my faith if my life were under threat for my faith? Those are three questions I would like for you to ponder over the next couple of days and use them as opportunities to introspect, to self-examine. Use them as opportunities to challenge yourself and your faith in God. Let us pray. Gracious God, as we pause to reflect upon what we believe you have been saying to us tonight. We acknowledge, good Lord, that because of the journey that we have taken to follow you, there'll be times when false accusations will be leveled against us. There'll be times, Lord, when things will be said that hurt to the core. There'll be times when things are done with malicious and covetous intentions. We ask, Lord, that you give us the grace, the tenacity, the wisdom, and the courage to respond as you would have us respond. But also, God, we confess that maybe there are times when we were the ones doing and making the false accusations. That there are times when we have said and done things that were not true about others. Forgive us, Lord. Lord, tonight we look into the whole matter of anger. And maybe, Lord, in this viewing audience, there are persons who have been struggling with rage and fury, a temper problem that has haunted and hurt them for many years. I pray for deliverance in the name of Jesus over that situation. And finally, God, I pray that whatever circumstances we face, whatever situations we come upon, where we are threatened because of our faith and our trust in you, Lord, help us to be as these three Hebrews who were willing and able, instead of renouncing their faith, that they willingly announced their faith and their confidence in you, even in the face of death. God, keep us true to you. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you for joining us. We hope you will join us again. Please remember to pray for each other and maintain the required social distance. There is power in prayer. Have a blessed week in the Lord.